But generally, I'd say that the boxing, the violence that we think of in boxing is more on the part of the audience. So that was an interesting discovery in the making of that piece. And skydiving, well, I have to say I've been skydiving since 1979, which is before I started art school or anything like that. I was studying sciences at Queen's University and ended up wanting to do something exciting while I was away from my parents, and I I looked at hang gliding, but it was, I think it was $200 for the course, and skydiving was $75, okay. So, you know, decision was made, and I found myself with a group of five or six people who instantly knew my name, unlike my courses in Psychology 101 and Chemistry 101, where there's thousands of students. And I just kept on doing it, and it has given me lots of pleasure and some pain over the years.
I think I can imagine, yes, I can imagine the pain. I hope it has just been a small
pain. Small pain, yes. Small pain, not big pain. And skydiving was fairly consistent up to about 1993, and then I kind of ran out of money and things till about 2003. I took almost 10 years off where I just did one or two a year, but since 2004 I started getting back into it, and now I'm having a lot of fun doing wingsuit flying.
Yes, I can remember when you first sent me the pictures or the videos of the guys who had invented the wingsuits, and then say, so yeah, first, how many jumps have you done?
1,865.
Very cool.
I have now 28 hours and 11 minutes of free fall.
That's pretty damn cool.
I have 25 base jumps as mm-hmm. well. From cliffs, bridges, well, base is an acronym for buildings, antennas, spans, and earth objects. Span is a bridge, of course.
You got all four?
Buildings, antennas, spans, and earth. Yeah, earth being a cliff.
Yes.
So my next project, I haven't done that for about 4 or 5 years, but I actually have signed myself up to do some base jumping from the cliffs in Norway in a month, in July. So, at the end of June. And I'm going to jump off the cliffs with my wingsuit, and I'm totally excited to do that.
That's very, very cool.
And the hardest part I find is bringing those kind of experiences into my art practice. For the most part, I tend to leave it. It's like, okay, that's skydiving, that's what I do as a kind of pastime, but it is pretty engaging. But there's lots of things about it that I think that are, like, you try to pull out little elements that are art to... They can work in an art context, and you know that's where force majeure was. It's sort of the beginning of a project, really, where I'm trying to remove skydiving from falling, and or flying, because in that work I had a video installation where I have five screens, and mostly the screens are empty with. Occasionally, clouds go by, and then, for a moment, someone falling or being blown up by the air goes up into the screen and then falls out. And I wanted to try to present people being on the edge of control with that presentation, like the idea of, like, either they have control and lose it, or they have no control and find it. And the idea of being that when you are in control, you are taking a risk. When you're out of control, you're vulnerable. And for me, like, one of those defining aspects of, you know, self, I guess, understanding is, like, the idea of... I'm trying to find the differences between risk-taking and being vulnerable. And being in drag... is sort of you become vulnerable in some ways, but when you do it, you sort of take a risk that you'll be socially, you know, outcast or, you know, put to, what's the word?
On the fringe?
On the fringe, yeah. Just sort of put to the side. But we're all outcasts somewhere. Like, I think that there's lots, when we become individuals, like when we actually try to work, you know, when our individuality manifests itself, we become automatically not part of the group in a way. So it's this dilemma that we negotiate every day.
I've never had any difficulties with that because I've never felt part of the group.
Well, that's it. You know, some people are comfortable with that, but if it catches you by surprise and you feel that you're being excluded or marginalized, it's not always pleasant. Mm-hmm. You know, it's... I don't know. It's not for me to say whether that worked or not. I think there's things I want to try now. I think there's things that work actually with still photography that you can play with better in that context than with video. But, you know, I thought it was pretty good effort for what it was.
I quite enjoyed it and stuff like that. It was the sort of thing I'm just now.
I know you didn't like the soundtrack. Nancy Tobin do the sound work. She's a sculptor, a sound designer, a sculptor. I call her a sound sculptor, but I think she calls herself a sound designer.
Okay. Yeah, if I remember correctly, it was just lots of wind and stuff.
There was wind. I played the drums in it. My friend Jackie played the drums in it.
You're definitely right. I didn't like it because I actually now have, thinking about it, I have no recollection whatsoever
of it. It was a hard track to pin down. Like after listening to it 50 times, I still didn't remember what was coming next, which I thought was one of its successes. I frankly thought that she really did a good job of keeping this kind of... I wanted her to generate... I mean, I didn't tell her what to do. I just sort of said, these are some of the ideas. And so she came up with a piece that I thought complemented the work quite well and didn't overwhelm the work. Mm-hmm. You know, I didn't want something that would be like a distraction from what you were thinking. I mean, with a soundtrack, you're creating a visual space as well, you know, so I wanted it to correspond with the idea of instability, really. Mm-hmm. I wanted the sound to be more about instability than anything. Well, I have to say the sound was something I really needed to keep the piece together in a formal way. You know, I it allowed me to work the different elements and time them, and you know, it was like a structure for me to work from, as opposed to her working to the video. Mm-hmm. I did something, she did something, it was an important aspect for me to time the piece all together. So
and it sounds like the way you're describing it.
And I loved working with her. She's a fantastic and really skilled audio.
That sounds, from the way you're describing it, where you're working together, almost like the boxing.
Yes.
Or the ASCII fighter, where it's a collaborative thing, although it's not performative, the performance is the two of you together to come up with something else.
It was really that, and that I really loved. And so if I got projects ahead of me, it's like, who am I going to do it? That's because it's always interesting to have a good conversation.
Exactly.
And it's not all on you. Then it's not all on you. And you know, having, like, I don't trust myself necessarily to be able to anticipate a viewer's response from A to Z through the work of a piece. And, you know, you try to, but, you know, it's fun to work with someone else and you see more, you get to see more.